a lot of tapes of people at seances and at sort of religious events that become possessed. And so, on one hand, you could say it, that this person is, you know, it's affect. But I do think that people believe, and there's something that shifts in someone's thinking and how they're feeling, and that they become someone else. And so I don't know how appropriate it is to talk about performance, because it's because we're discussing it out of a context. We're on the outside looking at it, trying to interpret it, right? But within that moment, it's a very authentic experience, right? So, I would say that PV was authentically having this experience, that that she found ways to channel at different moments throughout the day or in her life. And sometimes those moments were not convenient, you know. And for the purposes of the interview, I would believe that she really believed that she was in a state where she could receive Lacamo. Mm-hmm. So, no, I don't. I mean, I don't want to take that kind of experience away from anyone. You know, or try to trivialize it or explain it away, right?
To follow up on that, if you've ever interviewed somebody for, you know, to potentially hire them or something, if you're just doing it over the phone, you get one impression. If it's in person, you get about 70% more information.
Yeah.
When you see them speaking those words, you get so much more. So it's very hard to tell from a recorder exactly what's going on. It really is.
It's true. But in those photos, she does look like she's performing, right? So there's the photo that I showed of her sort of posing, standing in front of a wall, I believe, right? That's definitely performed. I felt it back here, see? So we can say that she's definitely performing here. She's dressed, she has masks in hand, on her face, etc. Right? Mm-hmm. But it's true, we do learn different things when people are in front of us, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask, to put you on the spot a little bit, but PV is now represented, the estate is represented by an outsider art gallery. As you pointed out, she's trained, classically trained in art, is considered visionary, I guess is why she's with an outsider artist. As a working artist, what do you think about those kinds of labels? We have this big show opening at the National Gallery this week that's looking at outsider art and modernism. Mm-hmm. If you wouldn't mind talking about that a little bit.
So there is when I was an undergrad, I went to undergrad at Florida State University, and for right now I cannot remember this artist's name, but there was an artist that lived and worked across from the flea market on the outskirts of Tallahassee, and she painted on doors, and she said that she had visions, God talked with her, and she did a lot of sort of biblical scenes on doors, family life, etc. And as a bunch of us students would go over there and just kind of knock on her door and just say, hey, what's going on? And so I would say, yeah, I would probably consider her an outsider artist, because what that implies is that you haven't had formal training, et cetera, haven't studied formally with anybody. But then there are artists that are classically trained and then make the decision to work in a different way, right? That kind of defies that kind of training. But there are also things that are happening in those works of art that where you can tell that someone understands and is using the kinds of principles of, the principles of design, you know, that we talk about in school. And that's evident in PD's work for sure. So I think it's problematic because of the content and because of where she sources her work, that she would be labeled an outsider artist, right? It categorizes her in a place that she crosses into but may not fully belong, right? And I think it's a way to sort of make less what she's done, right? Make it easy, right? By thinking that she can be easily plopped in another group of artists that have a different kind of background. But it's also a way to, it's just questionable because of her subject or content, her source, to say that she belongs here, because there are other artists that were visionaries, that were inspired, that had different kinds of sort of mental states that we would never consider outsider artists, but because they're making these representational paintings or these really beautiful, lush, easily understood landscape paintings, we would never dare to do that. But I also think it's something about when she was painting. This was like the early 1900s, right? 1930s or so?
Yeah, the entire right? 20th century,
exactly.
Basically.
And so it's also very easy to place her in that category, because she was a young woman when she married, got divorced, was sent to a sanitarium, came out, had this huge interaction and this really sort of traumatic sort of interaction with family, and was kind of pushed aside, right? And so it's also very easy to take all of that information and say outsider artist, right? So I think there's a lot wrapped up in how she's described. So that actually did not answer your question.
It's pretty interesting now.
Okay. And you don't have to share your personal opinion, but I think, yeah, it's a really, really complicated.
It is extremely complicated.
Question.
And I'm hesitant to say anything, you know.
Yeah.
Because you know, you could look at someone like Basquiat and say, outsider artist?
Right.
No. Right. You could, right? So,
yeah.
You know,
don't you think it really has to do with the story and not the art? Because if you looked at this work without knowing any of the story, I don't think any of us would say outsider art.
Which is exactly, it's not what I think, it's exactly what I said.
Right.
Yeah. That it's about the whole of her experience that's wrapped up into how she's being described.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. No, thanks for that question. It's a tricky one.
It is.
It's really sensitive.
And I think it's one that I've been asked multiple times since the show has been up, and I too am uncomfortable giving a concrete answer, because I think it yes and. I think there's just so much happening there, and the important thing is that the work is seen, not necessarily how it's labeled. So,
agreed. The other interesting thing I said to Lily is, was looking at the way that she's making these paintings and looking at the years, and then there was what was she doing? What was her Disney connection again?
Oh yeah, so she went to Chouinard for art school, which is it was an art school started, I believe, by Walt Disney. And so basically it was just students going in and learning really, really precise technical skills to then feed into the animation studios.
Yeah.
So I think that's also really apparent.
It is. Because there are artists that were working around this time that her work made me think about, like someone like Jules Engel. There is an artist in Boston who is the biographer for Jules Engel's. Dr. Jane Ann Dill, and she has cells and drawings that have forms in them that are very reminiscent to what PD is doing. And so it was around the same time frame. And he was at CalArts as well. Mm-hmm. And has a connection with Disney. Or actually, he drew scenes from Bambi. So yes, he does. So
okay.
Actually, I just had something to add. My background is mainly in science and engineering, and I'm reminded by a quote. There was a British statistician, his name was George Box, and he says, all models are wrong and some are useful. Models being the way that we look at the world, whether it's like religiously, philosophically, politically, etc. We're always skewed. Everyone has these different ways of looking at the world. Some are useful. So, you know, I would posit that, like, you know, who are we to say that she wasn't experiencing something very real for her? It was her model. And then it was just a case of like, okay, was this useful for her to create actual art?
Yeah.
You know, I might look at it and think like, oh, that sounds just a little bit weird to me. I'm not sure if that really applies. But, you know, we all have different ways of translating into our own realities what's going on. And they're all wrong. You know, every single model is going to be wrong. They're all going to be skewed, right? Is it useful to you? Is it a useful way of getting through your life? Is it a useful way of me doing science engineering or for her doing her paintings? Is it useful? If it was useful to her, then great. And I'm not going to say that, like, that's weird, that's wrong, because, you know, there maybe is no such thing as right or wrong.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. All models are wrong.
Some are useful.
But some are useful.
George Box. George Box. He probably did a lot of wonderful things. I only know him for that quote.
It's useful.
It's useful, right?
Thank you.
I think being considerate of time, unless there is someone with a burning question or comment, they have to get out. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.